And in this day and age, unfortunately, we have become so self-proud that everything that we do, we look for people to honor it. So rather than in the hadith, that فَإِنَّهُ يَدَعَ الطَّعَامَ وَالشَّرَابَ لِأَجْلِي, that he is fasting and he is leaving behind food and drink for my sake, which is indicating towards sincerity. Our hal and our condition is that everything that we do, not just fasting, everything that we do it for the sake of gaining appreciation, not in the court of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but fellow human beings. Human beings who have no power in us, in rewarding us or in punishing us for these deeds. Their appreciation has no meaning to it. It's futile. But everything that we do it for this reason. So, we're hooked on social media, and all we're looking for is gaining more and more followers, more and more likes. And we don't even know that these people who are liking us or following us, are they even real human beings or not? And even if they are, then what value is the appreciation of a human being, a mortal, who has no standing, not in this world, nor in the hereafter, in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But we are doing this for their sake. And this is very dangerous, my brothers. We're hooked on this. Everything that we do, not only dunya, but even deen. So we've got those people who are just concerned of the dunya. All their focus is that in the dunya, they acquire the aspirations, and for that they have this false portrayal and image of themselves on social media, and every few hours, every few minutes, they're doing something to gain appreciation of people. And generally, if you dig deep into the intentions, you'll find that it's to acquire dunya, the love of the world, wealth, it's to accumulate wealth, amass wealth. Why do they want followers on YouTube? Because so that they can earn money from it. So wealth. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned in the hadith that مَا ذِئْبَانِ جَائِعَانِ أُرْسِلَا فِي غَنَمٍ, that two wolves that are hungry for days, who haven't eaten for days, they are left in amongst a herd of sheep, of goats. مَا ذِئْبَانِ جَائِعَانِ أُرْسِلَا فِي غَنَمٍ بِأَفْسَدَ لَهَا, that the damage that they will do, compare that to the damage done in the next two things, is either equivalent or the next two things are even more worse in terms of damage and being collateral. What two things? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, مِنْ حِرْسِ الْمَرْءِ عَلَى الْمَالِ وَالشَّرَفِ لِدِينِهِ. Number one, the person's greed to acquire wealth, and number two, the person's desire to acquire honor and respect in his religion. If a person has these two motives, the damage that these two things will do is nothing less than, if not more, than the damage caused by wolves, two wolves who are on an empty stomach and have been released in a herd of sheep. Just imagine the situation there. The person's deen will be damaged far worse than that. Damage that will be done by those two wolves. وَشَرَفِ لِدِينِهِ, our situation. That we do things so that we can acquire honor in religion, so that people will say that this person is a religious person. He is a pious person. He is a righteous person. Doing it all the time to show people. Sayyidina Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu once entered into Masjid al-Nabawi, and he came across Sayyidina Mu'adh ibn Jabal radiallahu ta'ala anhu, who was sitting by the grave of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he was crying. Sayyidina Umar radiallahu anhu went to him and said to him, مَا يُبْكِيكَ يَا Mu'adh? What is making you weep and cry, O Mu'adh? So Sayyidina Mu'adh radiallahu ta'ala anhu said, that يُبْكِينِ, the fact that is making me cry is سَمِعْتُ النَّبِيَ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ يَقُولُ, I heard the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم say something, and I am remembering this hadith of Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم today, and so pondering on it, I came to the grave of Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم and I am crying for this reason. So Sayyidina Umar رضي الله عنه asked me to share with me this, because they were haris for ilm, for amal. So Sayyidina Mu'adh radiallahu ta'ala anhu said to Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu that Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said once that inna yaseer al-riya'i shirkun, the littlest of riya, of ostentation, of pride, of thinking yourself to be good and better, is shirk. It is equivalent to ascribing partners to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's polytheism. It's shirk. Inna yaseera riya'i shirkun. One thing was that. How many times do we fall into this? Riya. Riya. And like I just explained, this riya has taken a next level, a form that is never known in the past. This social media has taken riya to a level that we never, the ulama of the past never could have comprehended. And Rasulullah is equating it to shirk. Inna yaseera riya'i shirkun. And thereafter he said, the second thing was, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, and I heard him say this, that man aada li waliyan, that person who has enmity for my wali, then faqad barza Allah bil muharaba, then he is announced to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for battle. He is putting himself up in battle against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that inna Allah ta'ala yuhibbu al-abrar al-atqiya al-akhfiya. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves those who are righteous, abrar. Al-atqiya, those who have taqwa, who fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And al-akhfiya, and in this, in their righteousness and fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they remain hidden. Hidden to the extent that what? That idha ghabu, when they are not present, lam yutafaqqadu, then people don't go out looking for them. وَإِذَا حَضَرُوا لَمْ يُدْعَوْا وَلَمْ يُعْرَفُوا. And if they are there, then people won't go out of their way to call them or recognize them. So look at how Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is drawing our attention to the fact that a person should have tawadhu, humility in his life. He should try to remain hidden. That is why the aslaf used to remain hidden. How many times have we heard the different stories and incidents of our aslaf in how they conceal themselves? When Shaykh Umar Gangohi rahmatullahi alayhi would say that agar do baat ka ilm na hota, if it wasn't the fact that I have in the apparent acquired some knowledge of the deen, logo ko ye baat bhi malum na hoti ke Rashid Ahmad kahan paida hua aur kahan uski wafat hui, they would not know that where he was born and know where he has died. Shaykh Ulin rahmatullahi alayhi, we heard the incident where Mawlana came to visit him. At that time when his popularity was known all over India, he came to visit him because he had heard of Shaykh Ul-Hind rahmatullahi alayh. So he came specially to visit him, he had never seen him before. And so when the driver of the tanga dropped him off outside the house of Bade Molana, as he was known as in Deoband, then he went and somebody came at the door wearing a lungi and a vest. And he said that main Bade Molana ko milne ke liye aaya hun. So he said, tashreef laye, I have come to visit Bade Molana. So he said, come inside, you will be able to meet him just now. And he told him that it's a hot day, you've traveled a long distance, so sit down, I'll bring some water for you, so take some rest. He said, no, please inform Molana that I have come to visit him. And he said his name, that inform him that Molana Mu'inuddin from Ajmer has come to visit Molana Mahmudul Hasan, Shaykh Ul-Hind rahmatullahi alayh. He said, I will inform him, don't worry. And then he went inside. And then after a little while he came back. And he said to him that, you will be hungry as well, and it's afternoon now, so I prepared some food for you. So this person is becoming agitated now that I'm asking for Shaykh Ul-Hind rahmatullahi alayh, at least go and inform him that I have come to him, so he knows, he's aware. When he persisted and insisted, then finally Shaykh Ul-Hind rahmatullahi had to reveal that log is basti mein bade molana bande hi ko kehte hai, that people in this locality call bade molana this person, this humble one whose name is Mahmud al-Hasan. This is how they conceal themselves. And this is at that time where he was his peak, where he was known all over India as Shaykh Ul-Hind rahmatullahi alayhi. So my brothers, the lesson that we learn from fasting as well is that to train ourselves to inculcate this habit of ikhlas of a very high level, that we do things only for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because fasting is a perfect training ground for this. Because why? Because nobody knows. I could have gone to the fridge and taken out a bottle of water and drank it during the day. Nobody knows. So you're only doing it for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is the training, that only do a'mal for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If we do this, then in the hereafter we will gain acceptance. And these a'mal will be a means of not only acquiring reward, but like our Honorable Shaykh mentioned before, the Dhuhr Salah, it will be a means of advancing in our connection with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in taraqqi, in our ta'alluq with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give me and you all the tawfiq to act upon what has been said. Wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillah.